In this module, we will learn about the directions of the vertebrate nervous system and spinal cord. Understanding the directions of the vertebrate nervous system is essential to be able to treat tumors and understand the impact that such are having on behavior. The directions of the vertebrate nervous system are described in relation to the orientation of the spinal cord. Please note that the vertebrate nervous system is composed of three axes. We have anterior, posterior. Anterior referring to the nose end, posterior referring to the tail end. The second axis is the dorsal, looking toward the top, the spinal cord and the brain with quadrupeds in here. And then the other part, or the opposite, would be ventral, looking toward the bottom in the spinal cord or brain. And then the third axis would be medial and lateral, and medial referring to the midline of the body, or lateral will be away from the midline, facing toward the surfaces. Please note that when dealing with quadrupeds, we have perfect alignment of the arrows here, because the cats, while walking on all four, the spine does point upward just like the top of their head. However, with humans, that represents a shift in the spine, which will require that we rotate this 90 degrees. So whatever is dorsal here in human is now no longer going to be aligned as it is with the cat. It will now be the other way. And I'll show you in the next slide. Here you can appreciate the rotation that we had. You see, if the human had the head like this, similar to how a cat had it, then this would continue to be dorsal, but since we walk upright, dorsal in the brain refers to the top of the head, whereas ventral would be the bottom, anterior would be the nose end, and posterior the tail end. However, in the spine, anterior would be the top part, closer to our neck, dorsal would be toward our back, posterior toward the bottom, and ventral to the front. So please keep in mind this rotation, which is simply done by rotating 90 degrees and clockwise. Whatever you had here, simply rotate it, and now you have this outcome. This has not changed, where you have medial pointing toward the midline, whereas lateral would be toward the outside. These anatomical directions will come in handy, especially as we start looking into chapters 6, 7, and 8, and we start describing the specific sections and parts of our thalamus. Other directional terms that are used for humans is proximal and distal. Proximal, referring to proximity, and that is closer to the CNS. And distal, meaning far or farther from the CNS. Specifically, with regard to the PNS, proximal means closer to the CNS, and distal means farther from the CNS. Your shoulders are proximal to your elbows are proximal to your fingers, and so we refer to this in here. This is language that typically neurosurgeons use and neuroscientists use when describing the brain, as it would be somewhat ambiguous if you just simply said the top of something or close to something else. So please do be familiar with these directional terms. If you've ever seen an autopsy, either because you work in that line, in that field, or through a video, you would know that oftentimes a thorough autopsy would require the slicing of an organ that would be considered critical or to have played a role in the death of the individual. If we were to look at the brain, we would find that slicing the brain would reveal slicing the brain in specific forms would reveal damage in different parts of the brain depending on how we slice it. In the next few slides, you'll be seeing drawings of sections or slices of the brain that's cut from in one of three different planes. The planes that we see here is the horizontal, frontal, and sagittal. And as you can see, the horizontal plane is a slice or a section that's cut parallel to the ground. It would be this here. So if we were to take an individual that's standing upright and we then get a knife and cut it like this, we could continue slicing and slicing further and further and further until we slice up the entire brain in that fashion. The frontal, also known as coronal, would be slicing the brain like this, from the top down, but from left to right as well. So you'd have this, and you could do the same thing, slides all throughout, and you'd end up revealing the different parts of the brain that could have been damaged. The third plane that we see here is the sagittal, and that would be where you would take a knife, if you will, and you would cut exactly at half if you have a mid-sagittal section. However, you could also do sagittal on the rest, and you just continue slicing this, from the left to the right. It is through planes like these that posthumous analyses are done. You may remember earlier in 2017, the suicide of the famous football player who was incarcerated for killing one of his friends. Aaron Hernandez, the fullback for the New England Patriots, had been sentenced to life for the murder of a friend. And now this guy had a promising future with a newborn and a fiance, and he had just gotten a contract that was a multi-million-dollar contract, but his behavior was a bit odd. While going to a nightclub, he noticed that one of his friends was talking to a guy that he did not like. And while that would have not fazed the majority of us, and if it did, we would have let it go, he could not let it go. In fact, after that night, he began to plot the death of his friend, simply for talking to a guy that he did not like. This seems childish, it seems immature, it seems foolish, but there's much to be said as to why such behavior occurred. Now that you've taken and you've gone through some of these slides in here, you would understand that behavior is a byproduct of neurological activity. And so when he committed suicide, there was an analysis of his brain, and there were the results showed that there was enlarged cavities in different parts of the ventricles of his brain, and we believe that this degeneration of tissue could have contributed to his behavior, which was not consistent with what an individual in his position would do, or for the most part, any human being. Here you can see a frontal or coronal cut, which would be cutting the spinal cord. The spinal cord would then look like this, where you would have what we call these dorsal horns. Dorsal, remember, when looking at the spine, refers to back. And then you would have the ventral horns, which would, in the spinal cord, refer to the front. Here you can see that gray matter is pointed in this bluish or grayish color, whereas white matter is like right here. These would be the spinal nerves that would be connecting over to different parts of our body, making up the PNS. Here you see the other component. And what I'd like you to know is that white matter is the outer area, mainly composed of myelinated axons. So here you have white matter here and white matter here, and that is where myelination is. Given that it's inside the spinal cord, we know that we'd be looking at oligodendrocytes, which makes up white matter here. Gray matter, which you can perceive here, is the inner area, and that's primarily cell bodies and dendrites. There is no myelination there, and that's what we would have. Also, please note that the dorsal part of the spine is the part that receives the sensory, the afferent nerves. So everything you and I sense through our body and our skin and our feet and our hands would send a message over in synapse over to the back or the dorsal part of the spine. It would then be sent over to the brain, and then from the brain we would have an efferent nerve, a motor neuron, that would then activate, but the efferent would actually be coming out through the front. So everything that's received from our senses is sent to the back, and then everything that's an output, meaning the brain send a message out, then it would be coming out through the front. So here you can see the unipolar sensory neuron. You may remember the example of testing the water to see if it's warm enough yet, and it would come in through the dorsal, sends a message over to the brain. The brain then decides to activate motor neurons so you could jump in the shower, and so it would be activated and it would come out through the ventral horn, through the ventral top, that would then send a message over to your legs so you could jump in.